a series of lectures conducted by UGC. Frequently, we conduct lectures on various topics, and we invite students, faculty members, and heads of institutions from across the country. Some of them join on this Zoom platform. And this lecture is also live streamed on all the social media platforms of UGC. And there are several viewers watching this program on our social media platforms also. And these videos will be available later on our social media platforms, and they can be accessed again later also to gain more insights about the lectures that are given as part of the CHETNA series conducted by UGC. Today we have an interesting topic. This is about the National Archives of India and the resources that are available at the National Archives of India. We have the Director General of National Archives of India, who will be speaking on this, Shri Arun Singhal, and his lecture will be followed by Shri Syed Ahmad, who is the Deputy Director of the NAI. Friends, National Archives of India is a rich resource containing vast amounts of information on the history, culture, and the civilization and the society related to India. And these resources are available both in the physical form and also in the digital form. The National Archives of India makes these resources available to researchers, students, and faculty members across the country. It is for us to make use of this rich repository that is available in the National Archives of India, which can be used to design innovative teaching modules. You can use these resources to design interesting projects, quizzes, and assignments for your students. You can even design interesting courses, 3-credit course, 2-credit course, using these resources, which can be offered under various open electives that we plan to offer to the students as part of the 4-year undergraduate program. Friends, these resources can be used by economists, by social scientists, by even historians dealing with the technology. Today, we will hear more details about the resources that are available at NAI and how we can access these resources irrespective of wherever you are in the country through online means. So I first invite Shri Arun Singhal to make the presentation, and that will then be followed by the Deputy Director. And after that, we will open the session for a question answer session. So with those comments, I pass on to Shri Arun Singhal.
Thank you very much, sir. I think you've said all in the introductory remarks. Whatever I had to say has been encapsulated by you. So I'll just elaborate upon that. I must express in the very beginning, I must express my thanks to you when I met you about the need for better utilization of the rich information available in the Archives of India for research work. I remember that you immediately agreed about the need for more wider awareness about the National Archives, and you invited us to take part in this CHETNA series of lectures, which I must say is a great initiative by the UGC. It's a very good platform to interact with academic people, the top people in the academic world. And UGC has to be complimented for introducing this platform and sustaining this platform. So I'm very happy to be here today with you. And today, as we all know, the very auspicious date is Ganesh Chaturthi. Whenever we begin something good, we begin it on this auspicious day. So happy Ganesh Chaturthi to all of you, and I'm very happy to be here with you today. I'll share my screen to show the presentation. Okay, is it visible now?
Yes, it is visible.
Okay, great. So coming to the topic, the National Archives of India is the custodian of all the non-current records. That means records which are more than 25 years old are sent to National Archives by all the central government departments. In the case of digital records, e-files, it is different. Now they come in 10 years. So e-files which are more than 10 years old and documents which are more than 25 years old come to us. And this organization was established in the year 1891 at Calcutta as the Imperial Records Department. It was shifted to Delhi in the year 1911. And later on today, we are in the National Archives of India on the Janpath. It is a heritage building. Five buildings were designed by Lutyens and constructed together. They were the old Parliament of India, the President's of the Rashtrapati Bhavan, North Block, South Block, and the National Archives of India. All these were designed together by Lutyens and they were set up together. So we shifted into this building in 1926. And this organization was renamed as the National Archives of India in 1947. The earlier name was Imperial Records Department. Now we, of course, have a vast corpus of records, which include government records, private records. We have private archives of Dr. Rajendra Prasad, Rajaji, Subhash Chandra Bose, and many other private archives are there with us. There are cartographic records. We have lots of microfilm, and various sources have contributed to the treasure in the National Archives in the past. I'll play a small film, which was released on the 125th anniversary of NAI in 2016. In less than 5 minutes, this captures the essence of what NAI is. So with your permission, I'll play this film and then I'll resume.
The National Archives of India is the sentinel of the rich and vivid documentary heritage of the nation. Here records are cared, looked after, and revered so that this recorded legacy could be handed over from generation to generation. The National Archives of India was established as the Imperial Record Department on 11th March 1891 at Calcutta. Later in 1911, when the capital of British India was shifted to Delhi, the Imperial Record Department moved to the new capital. The present building was completed in 1926. It was designed by the famous architect Edwin Lutyens. Together with today's Rashtrapati Bhavan, Parliament House, North Block and the South Block, this building formed the nucleus of the new capital of India, the New Delhi. Soon after India achieved independence, the name of the department was rechristened as National Archives of India on 30th August 1947. The National Archives of India is headquartered at New Delhi with four regional centers at Bhopal, Jaipur, Pondicherry and Bhubaneswar. The main functions of the National Archives are divided into three areas: custody, care and consultation of records. The main holdings of the National Archives of India are the records of the government. Its regular series of official records starts from 1748 and continues in an unbroken succession. The records of the English East India Company, the British government in India, and the government of independent India all are preserved here scientifically for posterity. The National Archives has a unique collection of cartographic material that includes 42,000 manuscript maps, plans, and field books. The official series of records is aptly substantiated by the private papers of luminaries like Mahatma Gandhi, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, Dadabhai Naruji, Sarojini Naidu, Dr. B. R. Ambedkar, Field Marshal K. M. Kariappa, S. Ramanujam, Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar, Dr. Sampurnanand, and Purushottam Das Tandon.
Thank you. I think there was some issue with the audio towards the end. I'm sorry for that. But if you look at the functional units in National Archives of India, there's the records for archival records division. There's a division for reprography and digitization. There's a division for records management, that is acquiring records and transferring records. And there's a division for preservation of records. And there's an exhibition unit. And there's a school of archives where we provide training to people who want to work in the field of archives. Each and every document in the National Archives is individually taken off there. Lovingly and painstakingly, we repair and restore all the documents. And it's a very slow process, which actually requires a lot of skilled manpower, which is employed by us. I'll show you a small video, which was prepared by Rajya Sabha TV, which shows how documents are repaired and preserved. Once we laminate in this fashion, a document is safe for 100 years.
The National Archives has also invented a process of using heat and pressure in repairing and rejuvenating documents with the help of cellulose acetate foil and tissue paper. This process is known the world over as the cold or hand lamination process. It has the unique quality of repairing very weak, badly damaged paper or documents.
Document kuch agar kuch kharab ho gaya repair mein ya kisi ko original document dekhna hai to usko original sheet mein lane ke liye ye pehla principle hai archives ka ki unko jo bhi process kiya jaye lamination ya tissue repair ya sare reversible process.
So this was a brief glimpse of how we repair documents. Now, when it comes to giving access to documents, which is of interest to researchers, this is the part I want to dwell upon. Earlier, there was a facility that we still have it. It is called the reference zone, in which people come and look for records. There are indexes maintained in that room. And after going through them, they locate records, which are then given to them in the research room. There's a separate research room. So they make a requisition for documents, and the document original documents are made available to them in the research room for studying, and then they can make copies. This was the traditional way of functioning in the National Archives. In March 2015, we launched the Abhilekh portal. There's a web portal through which documents can be accessed now. So that is called Abhilekh portal, and now documents can be accessed offline, online, from any place where the researcher wishes to access them from. Now, this Abhilekh portal already has had about 1.49 lakh unique visitors and 2,70,000 hits. There are 24,000 users who are registered on this Abhilekh portal. And we have so far hosted about 1.5 crore pages on this Abhilekh portal. What I mean by hosting is, let me explain the Abhilekh portal to you through some snapshots. This is the portal, the face page of the portal where you land when you go to a Abhilekh portal. Now, this is the registration page. In order to search for a document in a Abhilekh portal, no registration is required. Anybody can come and search at any time. We don't require any kind of registration whatsoever. Anybody can search. But if you want to view a document, then you will have to register and log in. So this is the registration page. It's a simple registration process. Now, this is the kind of search you can perform on the Abhilekh portal. You type something in the search bar over there, and immediately results will be thrown up to you. For in this case, for instance, 11,433 records have been thrown by the Abhilekh portal, which can be further refined. There are different categories, and it can be searched by years or time duration, whatever it is. So you can refine the search further. Now, this is the way. If you click a document of the list which was shown earlier, if you click a document, you see a page like this, where some metadata about the file or the document is given here. But then if you want to see the document, then you have to log in. Once you log in after registering, then you see this window. This is the window which you see. In this window, the document is displayed. And there's a button here for full screen. The document can go full screen. Now this document has 13 pages, and all the pages can be scrolled through here. They can be seen on full screen mode. But if you want to take a download, then you have to go to page on demand, which is over here, and request some pages. There's a nominal charge for downloading pages that has to be paid. Any document which is available in the digitized form on the Abhilekh portal can be downloaded from Abhilekh portal directly after paying the fees. The other thing we have is something called digitized on demand. If a document has not yet been digitized, we have a process of digitizing documents. We keep on doing that all the time. If a request is made for a particular document, we can prioritize the digitization of that document, and then we can make it available on the ability portal. So the researcher may choose to request for digitization on demand, in which case within a period, reasonable period of a week or so, he should be able to download the document from the ability portal only. When you click digitize on demand on any particular document, then you reach this page and then you have to make a request. Now, if a document is not yet digitized, then you can come to the reference zone in National Archives of India. These are pictures of the reference zone. And after locating some document in the indexes over there, that document can be requisitioned. There's a research room in which the document would be made available to anybody who wants to have a look at the document. These documents are all precious and we don't allow them to go out of the archives. For instance, if the Rani of Jhansi wrote to the British government about doctrine of lapse, we have the original letter. Somebody could come and see it. It is a thrilling experience. But we would not allow that to go out of the archives anywhere. So original documents can be consulted in the research room that we have. Now, we are undertaking a very extensive digitization exercise. To tell you about that exercise, the basic objective is that nobody should have to come to National Archives of India to look at a document. We would like that all the documents that we have should be available online. People should be able to access them freely without any hassles. There should be complete ease of access. So as of today, we have about 70 lakh documents with us, which we estimate run into about 34 crore pages. Now, they are of interest to students of history, and not only history, that is the traditional view that only historians would be interested, but they are interesting for students of political science, students of foreign relations, economics, sociology, anthropology, physiology, languages, religion. All kinds of interesting documents are there with us. Of the 70 lakh documents that we have, about 15 lakh have already been digitized and they have been made available on the Abhilekh portal. So you can actually see these documents on Abhilekh portal and download them. Now, for the remaining documents out of the 70 lakhs, 15 lakhs have been already put on Abhilekh portal. The remaining 55 lakh documents also, their indexes and references have now been put on Abhilekh portal. So earlier, to locate these documents or to identify these documents, one had to come to the reference zone. Now we have put all the references on Abhilekh portal. So even if a document has not been digitized, it is not available actually on the Abhilekh portal, reference to that document would be available. One can glance through all the references and identify documents for requisitioning. That can now be done on the Abhilekh portal only. And then of course, digitized on demand requests can be made. We are now working to digitize all our documents in the next 2 years. Now, this is a humongous exercise. We have to digitize about 30 crore pages in 2 years. So that means we'll be digitizing 6 lakh pages, 6 lakh pages per day. It's not a small number, 6 lakh pages. And there are challenges in terms of the IT infrastructure, in terms of physical availability of resources. But we are up to the challenge. We have floated a tender and we're going to do it. So within 2 years, all the documents that we have in the National Archives of India will be available online. And nobody will have to come to the National Archives to have a look at any document. Everything would be available online. Some other initiatives that we are taking include talking to the state archives. Every state has archives, and some states have bigger archives than the National Archives of India. There are states which claim they have 40 crore pages. So Jammu Kashmir has 9 to 10 crore pages. Rajasthan has 40 crore pages. So there are huge archives in the states of India also. And then there are, of course, private archives also. So now we are encouraging all the states and UTs to come together in a combined fashion on one portal. So if you search for, let's say, Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, whatever is available in the National Archives, as well as West Bengal government or any other state archive, should be thrown up together. After that, obtaining a copy can be obtained from the concerned state archive. But the search mechanism should be common. So we discussed this in the National Committee of Archivists very recently, and there was complete consensus on this. We have to look at the metadata which has been stored by various states. And if there are differences in the metadata formats, they have to be reconciled. But we are working on this, and we'll have a common search portal for all the national and state archives together. We are also trying to build up an AI-based search engine to improve the quality of search in our archives. For instance, suppose there's a photograph of Subhash Chandra Bose in some document. and that is not named by the author, then the AI can pick up that this is a photograph of Subhash Chandra Bose, and it can show that result also. So using AI, we want to improve the quality of search mechanism. We are working on this. We are also planning to have a section devoted to National Archives in all national libraries and museums, where people can, there should be a kiosk in which you can go and see the archives. If you are in a museum, there are some documents also which are interesting. They should be visible to the public. We'll be very happy to collaborate with any university which is willing to set up a section for archives in their library and to consider free access to records. To bona fide researchers, we can provide free access if any university is interested. That is an offer I'm making to all of you. We are also working on something which we are calling unified access to all the heritage information available in the government. On the right side of this slide, you will see a list of many, many institutions which have heritage information, whether it's museums, Lalit Kala Academy, Parliament Museum, Indira Gandhi National Center for Arts, Maulana Abul Kalam Azad Institute of Asian Studies. I saw the original manuscript written by Aurangzeb. He used to write the Quran. That is there in Aligarh Muslim University. I've seen it over there. There are many important, very good things in Raza Library. So there are a number of institutions in which archival information is available in the broad sense of the word, not only documents. Now, if a researcher has to go to 50 different portals to look for information, it is cumbersome. It is against ease of access. So in One Nation, we want to have one portal where all the heritage information available in the government should be searchable. So I've spoken to the Sector Information Broadcasting. Films Division has archives, Doordarshan has archives, Akashwani, All India Radio has archives. We have archives. So what we want to do is to combine all these things. The metadata from all these sources should be combined onto one portal. And then if a researcher wants to do some research, he should simply be able to go to this portal, type whatever he wants to search about, and whatever resources are available in the entire government setup or even private universities should all be thrown up to him. So we are working on this possibility, and hopefully in the future we'll be able to implement this. I need not emphasize that NAI resources can really be a treasure for researchers from most disciplines. We have a common interest to promote education research based on primary resources. The archives we have are primary resource material and a huge amount of material. Actually, I have basically a staff of 200, 300 people. And I have 34 crore pages. There's no way my staff can actually go through these pages and see what is there. It is up to researchers to come and discover these pages, the wealth of information which is there, to discover that. And I would really request all of you that whenever students or researchers are provided a list of primary resource materials, the National Archive should invariably be included in that list. It would also be wonderful if some optional courses can be introduced, especially for students of BA History and MA History, which use archival material. As the chairman was saying, some credits can be given and people can be encouraged to go. It's very easy to look at the archives now because of Abhilekh Patel. It can be done online, and we anyway welcome researchers who come to us. So if a course can be introduced, it can be optional and people can be encouraged to take up that course, then they can perhaps sift through the information that we have in the archives. And many gems would be unearthed if people start looking into these archives. In the end, I would just like to say that we are celebrating the Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav right now. You are aware of that. And as is written here, there can be no better way to start than by looking at the rich traditions and culture of India, which is captured in our historical records. So any proactive action which is taken by the Honorable Vice Chancellors in this regard would help to unlock the treasures hidden away in our archives and would definitely bring out new insights into the valuable heritage of India. Thank you. Farid sir, would you like to add something? Syed Farid Ahmad has been at the archives all his life. I am a very recent entrant. I've been there only for 4 months. So Farid Saab has a very deep insight into archives. Would you like to say something, Farid Saab?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Chairman, sir, and DG, sir, for giving me an opportunity to speak on this great platform. It's an immense pleasure. Most of the things our DG sir has already covered our expectation with regard to the effort and expectation we are expecting from UGC with regard to usage of most of the documents available in National Archives of India. Our scholars every day, about 50 to 60 scholars, they are pouring and they are utilizing the documents. And as far as National Archives is concerned, they are making the best effort to bring the maximum records for the use of the scholar. We are also trying our best to bring the classified records after declassification. Because there is always demand from the scholar for such type of rare documents, which we are not able to get because since it is not declassified. So that effort is also being made by our director general. He has been writing letters to the secretaries, and we are regularly visiting those ministries so that those type of rare document could be transferred to National Archives, which will be of great use to the scholars for writing their research work, especially related to history. As far as our School of Archival Studies is concerned, sir, we are teaching those subjects which is relates to conservation, reprography, and record management, archives administration, which is rarest in our country. And our alumni, they had been employed in various parts of the world, and in India also. If the universities, I would request if they are taking up the university archives, so there will be lot of records which can be utilized, which is available in these universities. So this is all, sir. Thanks a lot for giving the opportunity. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Shri Ahmad ji. Arun Singhal ji and Ahmad ji have given a very comprehensive view of the National Archives of India. You know, most universities have a library page on their website. We will formally write to all the universities to include a link of the National Archives of India on the library of all the universities. One of the challenges is that although we have this rich repository of data related to India in our National Archives of India, the awareness about it is limited. And that is the reason why I think our rich resources are not effectively used. The idea behind this lecture is to create that awareness. We will open this proceedings for question answer session also. But before that, I have a couple of questions. One, you said that the documents are preserved through a technical process, but their lifetime is only about 100 years after this preservation process. So what will happen to the document after 100 years? Is it still usable, or will it be damaged?
Okay, so what I was saying, we have documents which are up to 1500 years old. We have original farmans by Nur Jahan of the Tughlaq dynasty. So I said 100 years at one time. The process that we use is a reversible process. If you go for traditional lamination in plastic, then the document is destroyed. You can never recover the document again. If you open a lamination of plastic, then the document will be torn to pieces. It will not come out. The lamination process that we use is a different process, in which if you put it in hot water, the document can be recovered because the document is precious, not be destroyed. So we may have to repeat this after 100 years, and we'll keep on doing that in perpetuity. But the documents would be available and safe. The only thing is, documents If we touch them, if we thumb through them, if we disturb them, they don't like it very much. So documents actually theoretically like to be fumigated and left alone in an air-conditioned environment where humidity and temperature are controlled. And if we can provide copies of them to the world at large, that is the best, instead of people actually coming and looking at the documents. So we have very limited and restricted access to documents, but we would like to give access to their digitized copies to everyone. So copies will be available to everyone. The original documents will be preserved by us for all times to come. We'll take care of them for all times to come. We'll never lose that.
So the other question I have is, there is a lot of archival material related to India in other places, like in England or in some other university libraries or other places across the globe. Is NII planning to access those resources also and make them available to our researchers through this common portal?
That's very right. We have MOUs with many countries on sharing of the archival information that is available. Actually, when country archival information, for instance, when Pakistan was created, we did not part with our archives. We provide copies to them, but we don't give the original documents. So there is information in India about many other countries. For instance, very recently, Saudi Arabia sent a delegation here, and we were actually able to show them the original document by which the name Saudi Arabia was given to that country. Because the British used to govern many countries from India, and we have records of... So many countries find interest in our records. We had a request from Bangladesh about Sheikh Mujibur Rahman and the activities of Mukti Bahini. We had some information with us. So we provide information to other countries. Other countries also provide information to us on records that are of interest to us. So we have MOUs and we pursue this all the time. Apart from that, of course, there's a minor provision which we have. If some documents pertaining to India are being auctioned somewhere in the world, we are authorized to go and purchase them. We are authorized to go and bid for them. So the bidding route is available. The diplomatic route is available. Voluntary donation route is available. We do persuade private individuals to donate their archives to us. And we maintain their name in eternity. Like if Subhashan Bose, he has donated his archives to us, then it'll always be called Subhashan Bose papers. We'll preserve that name. So anybody who donates the private archive to us, his name would be immortalized by us. So we do acquire through diplomatic channels and by auctions, bidding, purchase, etc., documents from foreign countries.
Is there any plan to integrate your resources with Chat GPT?
As I was saying, we are working on an AI-based search engine. Right. So in that process, perhaps the technical team may utilize Chat GPT. But since all our resources are publicly available, Farid Saab made this point that nothing which is classified comes to us. As per our act, only documents which have been declassified would come to us. So if there's a particular war for which we've decided not to declassify the report, they would not be available with us. Whatever we have is in the public domain. And therefore, theoretically, any search engine or AI-based Chat GPT, etc., should be able to peep into our archives and throw up information to people at large. But what we are working on is our own search engine, where search would be somewhat intelligent as compared to what it is today. And records are public. They are available to Chat GPT or Bard or any other AI system.
Now, these are some of the questions that are popping up on our social media thing. So that's why I'm asking you. The yes. Other question that has come is, somebody says, we have some documents of historical value. How can we contribute it to NAI? And the related question is, can we retain the original documents with us and give only the copy of the heritage material to NAI?
Okay. So when people have private archives, then we, first of all, if they are in a position to take care, it requires some money and expense and love and care to take care of old documents. So if they are in a position to take care of these documents financially and otherwise, we are willing to extend our help in terms of expertise. If they want, we can send a team to look at the condition of the documents, whatever treatment is required can be advised by us. There can be termite attacks, there can be silverfish, there can be acidity in paper, because which paper becomes brittle and yellow. So we are willing to provide a technical expertise to them if they would like to do it. If they would like to send some people to us to get trained, we can provide training to their personnel. If they feel that they do not have the wherewithal or the resources to take care of these old documents, then they can offer the documents to us and we are happy to take them over as private archives. The only thing is that we would assess what is the value of those papers. When any department, even a government department, offers papers to us, we perform an appraisal as to what is of national significance and what is not. So normally we end up taking about 3 to 5% of the papers which are offered to us by government departments. In private archives also, we deputed a team. Very recently, we acquired the Rambaksh Singh papers from Lucknow. So we send a team to go and look at the papers, whether they are of national importance. And if we feel that they are of national importance, we are happy to take them over. As I said, we'll retain the name of the person who has contributed the record always and maintain the records at our place. If somebody wants to provide copies of the documents that he has, he's most welcome to do that. We'll assess the quality of the copies and we place them in our on our digital portal that we can do.
Right, right. You know, beyond the National Archives of India connection, I have a common connection with Shri Arun Singhal and also Ahmad ji. Shri Arun Singhal is a B.Tech and M.Tech from IIT Kanpur. So we both are from the IIT system. And Shri Syed Ahmad is from JNU. He did his MPhil there. So we have another common connection there. It's very wonderful to have you both on this platform and speak about NAI. We will now open for question and answers. You can electronically raise your hand and our technical team will unmute you and you can pose the question. So I'm just looking at the screen to see if there are any hands. Meena Gautam, our technical team, may please unmute.
Yes, good morning, sir. Myself, I am Dr. Meena Gautam, and good morning to our DG National Archives also, sir. I've been working with National Archives, and I retired as Deputy Director from National Archives of India, and I've been associated with some projects and writing articles. I conducted a project on archival education in India, sir. And I visited most of the universities in India and I wrote an article on university archives. So my concern is, sir, UGC had taken up this giving financial assistance to universities to set up their archives. But during my survey, which I conducted under ICHR project study during 2018 and 20, I found that most of the universities, including Delhi University, Jamia, and our JNU, they don't have their administrative records. They are more than 100 years old. They have celebrated their centenaries. So I visited all these archives. I met their deans and all senior officers. But I was sorry to say that administrative records are not available with them. Jamia is having a literary archives on Premchand. Delhi University is a more an exhibition rather and holding their own old records of the university. Rather, NAI has many records of the Delhi University. Similar is the story of the JNU, sir. My concern is, why can't we have archives in our universities like we have in European and Western countries? And further, sir, most of the people are interested in use of archives and digitization, but we don't focus on the training and conservation of these records. And all these universities, they don't have a single course. Only three places, National Archives is having a school where I was as the head of the School of Archival Studies till 2012. Then there is Osmania University along with Telangana the State Archives. They're hosting just with 12 seats customized to their own needs. And Kerala Heritage Society, sir. All throughout the country, there is not a single university hosting any course like that on archival studies. They want to use archives, but they don't want to work on conservation, preservation, and all those technical and scientific methods being adopted universally, sir. And we are far, far, far behind many of these international practices, sir. We boast of our something which we are doing right now, but we need to do much, much more, sir. So this is my concern, and this is something which I wanted to share, sir, because I visited many of the upcoming archives and they all want trained archivists, which we are not able to provide. Even they don't find our training at National Archives good enough to appoint even Rajasthan State Archives. They don't consider our training good enough to be posted trained archivist in their state archives. So there are many these facts which I think we need to address and bring our education policy, archival national policy should be there. And sir, we should have something from the UGC portal, sir. Because I've been a member of the committee also of the UGC when they were talking about appointing a university archivist and other people. So I had sitting and I discussed with them and they accepted our degree, diploma rather, as one of the qualifications. It's not essential, but an optional qualification. So these are some of the concerns which I wanted to share, sir. Thank you.
Meenaji, you have expressed concerns and also have given very constructive suggestions. Thank you very much for your feedback. I do agree with many of the suggestions that you have made. A couple of things that I would like to share for the consideration of the educational institutional heads who have joined here and also the faculty members is that now that we have the NEP 2020 and we are providing a lot of flexibility, I think the universities can make use of these resources to give projects and assignments to the students to promote interdisciplinary education in the university system. For example, if there is an engineering student, the engineering student can do a project on the technological history of India by sourcing the material that is available here. Similarly, you know, a sociology student can do some online project using these resources. I think only the sky is the limit. You can use your imagination and create a lot of these kind of educational activities for our students so that they can use these resources. And the other suggestion I have is perhaps UGC will separately will discuss with Arun Singhalji. We can actually create a 2-credit or 3-credit course content and make this model syllabus available to the universities. And they can make use of the resources, digital resources that are available at NAI and offer these courses as electives, irrespective of in which discipline the student is there. This is something that we will definitely work with the NAI. The other suggestion that I have is that we also encourage a lot of MOOC courses to be prepared so that they can be launched on this FIM. And you know that students can take up to 40% of their total credits for a program on SWAM. So if we can create an online 3-credit course and related to the archives, we will be very happy to work with NAI to prepare this course and then launch it on SWAM. And when it comes to the university archives, it is a rich information that every university has. Definitely, I think we need to at least put efforts to digitize that information so that that information can be accessed by researchers across the country. So I pass on to Arun Singhalji. Perhaps he may have additional information to add to what I said.
Thank you very much, sir. Those are very good offers. We are so delighted to hear them. We'll definitely love to work with you on these things. This is what we wanted. I'm so happy that you have agreed to do this. Extremely grateful to you. And to Meenaji, I just want to say two things. One is that you've been at the School of Archival Studies, and if you find that the you've been touring around and you find the quality of education in the school is not as good as it should be, then please come to us, give us feedback. Syed Farid Ahmad Sahib is the person looking after school right now, School of Archival Studies. So please give us the benefit of your insights that you have developed by touring around and talking to people. And we went to Rajasthan very recently. The National Committee of Archivists was held in Bikaner. Mr. Khargawat was there and they were very happily. They have no issues taking people trained at NAI. But anyway, whatever improvements are required should be made. So please give us the benefit of the knowledge that you have acquired by coming to us. You are most welcome.
Definitely, sir. I will be.
The second thing is, you know, you raised a very fundamental issue about the culture of archiving in the country. You talked of universities, but I'm saying this is a general thing. The British government laid a lot of emphasis on archiving, documenting everything. And no country has become great by losing sight of its past. You have to document the past, you have to learn from the past, you have to improve upon what you have done in the past. I mean, the amount of detail they used to record was, it went down to this. I saw a file in which it was written that the Rani of Jhansi was killed and she took 20 minutes to die. And there was another lady with her who was a Mohammedan who always used to be with her. The Mohammedan lady was sent for burial. Rani Lakshmibai's corpse was sent for funeral. So even the small thing that she took 20 minutes to die, it sounds a bit gruesome, but this is what they've recorded this in the file. Everything, you don't have to be very verbose, you know, you don't have to write long volumes about everything in life, but everything should be recorded. That culture of archiving should be there, and understanding the value of your history should be is something which is by everybody in the country. So developing a culture of archiving is necessary, and through our outreach activities we do try to tell people. But this is a campaign which all of us have to join. And at the university level, you have the young mind with you, young student is there with you. If you inculcate this value, this importance of documentation and archiving in the mind of the young person who's there with you, that will go a long way in curing this malady that we don't document things properly in the country. So that is a general malaise on which we have to work together. You have very rightly raised that point. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. I'll be meeting you soon, sir. Thank you, sir.
Most welcome. Most welcome.
There is a question, Arun Singhalji, to you. Is this NAI, does it have any value for medical researchers?
Oh, yes, absolutely. I mean, you will find there have been medical researchers who contributed. Government has recognized their contribution. There are government files. We have files of the patent office also. So there would be many things available there. You have to look for them. It takes a long time to go through all the archives. Recently, people came to me from a foreign country. They said, we would like to have all records pertaining to our country. So I said, you know, I can't find out those records for you. You have to depute two researchers who will come and sit and research, look at all the records and find out what is interesting. The moment you identify something, we'll provide it to you. But in this entire ocean of information, you have to locate the information that you want. All kinds of information is available.
Right. There is another related question. Are there documents and information available for yoga researchers?
Why not? There should be. Farid sir, would you like to talk about this? You know more about what is available in the archives than I do.
Sir, it may be available. I'm not very much confirmed because that period covers the initial stage of the yoga at that time in the earlier 19th century developments in which yoga had some role. So those type of files can be available in the files related to the medical branch series mainly. We have a less collection of the medical branch, but in that medical branch series there must be these type of files available. But I'm not very much sure, sir, because it requires a proper search.
Right. Right. So there's another question. It says the National Archives of India, how much back does it go in terms of historical material that is available? Is it a couple of hundreds of years or even a thousand years?
The oldest manuscripts we have are the Gilgit manuscripts. They are 1500 years old, 5th or 6th century AD. They are written on birch leaves and they are about 1500 years old. We have many palm leaf records in Bhubaneswar. We have French records. So it's basically 1500 years. The regular British files are available from the mid-1700s, as was mentioned to you. But before that, we have records of the Tughlaq dynasty, the Mughal dynasty, as I said, Farmans by Nur Jahan. Some old Nikah Namas are available, which are actually in gold and silver. Gold and silver has been used on paper. So, but the oldest documents we have are about 1500 years old.
Okay. One question, and I think it's a relevant question. I know you have an ocean of information. Are you planning to introduce the modern techniques of searching in a pointed way? I think you have partly answered, but I think if you can,
yes.
That it will be good.
So, as I was saying, we have a search engine right now, which is a rudimentary search engine. Search can be at many levels. What we are doing now is we are digitizing these documents, we are scanning all of them. Then we are running optical character recognition on handwriting recognition on them. After that, we are translating them into English. Documents are in French, Odia, Bengali, all kinds of documents are there. So we are translating every document into English. Now there's a metadata in every document, which is the subject of the file and the year and the file number. That is the very basic metadata. So you can have a search at the metadata level. That is a limited search. There could be a more complicated search in which you extract keywords from the entire document. that can be done by artificial intelligence. And then you can search through all these keywords. It will be a much more focused, much better search. But then, of course, the last thing would be that once we digitize and convert everything into English, it is OCR and handwriting recognition takes place. Then you can actually search through the entire contents of every document in the National Archives. That would be a very slow and cumbersome process. So search can be of many kinds. And depending on the complexity of the search, the time taken, because the number of pages I'm talking about is 34 crore pages. When I store them in digital format, it takes 16 petabytes of space at my headquarters. So it's a huge amount of information. One can search through that in a variety of ways. But of course, balancing the time required for a search and the value of the search would require artificial intelligence. So we are working on that. The agency which is maintaining Abhilekh Patel, we have asked them to start working on artificial intelligence-based models so that the search can be faster and more focused and useful for the researcher. That we'll have to work upon. But today, of course, a researcher learns by trial and error. When he comes, he performs a search, he gets some results, then he performs some other search, he gets some other results, and the search process is refined by human intelligence. We want to supplant that with artificial intelligence. We'll work on that.
Right. I am also seeing repeated questions on, somebody asked whether the archival material is available in yoga field. Somebody is asking whether it is available in pharmaceutical sciences. Somebody is asking something else. Perhaps from the academicians and university point of view, on the NAI portal, if some classification can be done, discipline, broad discipline wise, sciences, history, archaeology, within sciences, maybe some more disciplines. If such kind of classification can be done, it will be easier for us. And that's the feeling I'm getting from the questions. Would you like to say anything on that?
That's a valid suggestion. And the only thing is our archives are organized, more like the Ministry of External Affairs, Ministry of Home, Ministry of Science and Technology. So they are not really organized topic-wise. The repositories that we have are not organized topic-wise. To do this, we'll have to actually peep into the contents of each repository and identify which documents pertain to what. So that, as I said, is easier done once we digitize all the documents so that electronic searching is possible. Today, we have to go through these lists manually and go through the documents manually to see what is contained in them. That is a very time-consuming process. So we'll be in a better position to do all this once we complete the two-year process of scanning and digitizing all the documents, whereby everything becomes electronic in form, and then searching, bunching, categorization, all that can be done more easily. So we'll keep this suggestion in mind, we'll work on this, but it may not be feasible in the short run, it may be a slightly long-term exercise.
Right. Arun Singhalji, there is a very interesting suggestion that has come. The questioner is saying, what are the different kinds of technological challenges that you are facing in the NAI work? Is it possible to collaborate with technological universities to find solutions to the challenges that you are facing?
Oh, yes, we look for this all the time. Very recently, yesterday, we had an interaction about carbon dating of old documents. There are many documents that we have where the date is not really mentioned. We don't know what time they are from. So we have tried to do carbon dating. And because documents can't be destroyed, we can't destroy the whole document to find out its age. So basically what we discussed yesterday was that a sample of 5 milligrams is required to do carbon dating. So that is one area in which we are collaborating. There are other kinds of problems. For instance, when I scan 30 crore documents in the next 2 years, about 15% of them, let's say 4.5 crores, are in such bad state that they cannot be scanned right now. They have to be repaired first. Now that means normal at my pace, current pace, I would repair these documents in 80 years. I want to do them in 2 years. So I need more material. Now we have hit upon this bottleneck that the transparent sheet tissue, which is used to encapsulate sheets, papers, is manufactured only in Germany. Nobody in India has been able to manufacture that so far. And the quantities which are available are very limited. So if I want to go up 40 times, I cannot because the material is not available. So I want to develop translucent paper, which is somewhat transparent, but it is strong at the same time. In India, this is a make in India thing we want to do. So we were thinking of collaborating with the CPPRI in Saharanpur to see whether they can develop some paper which can be used by us in our repair work. So there are many kinds of challenges, and we would love to work with institutions, universities, technical institutions to do all this. We are already working in a limited way, but this is welcome and we would like to collaborate. There are many kinds of challenges which we face.
I am receiving more than anticipated number of questions, but I think
that's great.
I will ask you two last questions, which are there in my chat box here. One is that just now you said that the contents had to be read to actually find out to which discipline they belong. The question here is there a possibility that some of these archival material can also be made available in other Indian languages?
Okay. So translation, we are working on translating everything into English so that a common search engine can actually work. But if you want to translate a document which is in Bengali to, let us say, French or Tamil, we have not done so far. The document can be downloaded, and then there are many AI-based instruments available for translation. So individuals can translate. But if we translate, then the question of accuracy of translation comes up, then we have to give lots of disclaimers. So we are not doing this as a general rule. We don't translate into other language. We keep documents as they are. But for the purpose of facilitating search operations, we will translate them only into English. A common search engine can be made to work upon them.
Arunji, one last question. Although you initially mentioned about it, but since this question has come and it is of interest to everybody, the questioner says, the National Archives of India has both online resources and also the physical resources. As a researcher, as a student, if I want to access this material, please tell us the procedure.
Okay. So online material, as I said, you go to the Abhilekh portal. There you can search for the material that we have. The search does not even require any registration or login. You can search and results will be displayed. To actually look at those documents, you have to register, and then you can look at documents free of cost. To download them, you have to pay a small fees. Now, about 15 lakh out of 70 lakh documents have already been digitized. They are available on the Abhilekh portal in digital form. The remaining are not. The remaining can also, references to all of them are available on the Abhilekh portal now. So if you identify a document which has not yet been scanned or digitized, and you want to have a look at that document, you can place a demand for digitize on demand. And it will be prioritized in terms of digitization. It will be made available to you through the Abhilekh portal. If for some reason you want to have a look at it immediately, you want to come to National Archives, then you have to put in a requisition, which will also be available online. You can register online and send a requisition online. A pass also will be generated online. Come and have a look at the appointed day. The document will be made available to you in the research room. And it's occasionally, if you choose to come and see, it's very thrilling, you know, reading about, I saw the assassination of Mahatma Gandhi. An FIR was lodged in the Parliament Street police station. That original FIR is there with us. So looking at that FIR, it gives me goosebumps even today. The original document is something else. Seeing a copy of it is a different experience. But seeing the original document is something entirely different. So we would encourage all of you to come. We organize exhibitions. You are welcome to come there. If any university is coming to us, we can organize a special visit for you. So actually looking at documents is one thing. But of course, copies would be made available to you through the portal. You can inspect a document in our research room and take copies of it from the research room.
Right. Great. Arunji, I think we spent 30 minutes for the lecture part and nearly 30 minutes for the question answer session. Your lecture has ignited so much of interest in the National Archives of India. Usually our online programs are watched anywhere between 5,000 to 10,000 people across the country. And later many more viewers will come back and watch these programs. And I'm sure this lecture will provide great information and ignite the minds of our young scholars across the universities to make use of these rich resources that are available. I would like to thank both Shri Arun Singhal and Shri Syed Ahmad for this wonderful interaction with our academicians across the country. Thank you very much.
I would like to thank you, sir, for the opportunity, and we look forward to working with you on the things that were discussed today. Thank you very much.